Happy Sunday morning, everybody. My name is John Rocha. I am the host of Collider Mailbag, and I am crazy excited to welcome another new guest to the show, or first-time guest to the show, a guy I've gotten to know a lot through the Schmodown and also through his work in this sphere. I want to welcome Winston A. Marshall to Collider Mailbag. What's up, brother?
What's going on, Rocha? Thank you for having me, man.
How are you, man?
I'm good. I mean, we were talking beforehand. I'm a little tired. I don't know why I thought that playing video games and eating Oreos would put me to sleep when I couldn't go to sleep. But, you know, like, sometimes you got to try.
Hey, that's man, it. You're young. Enjoy your youth. I remember doing that stuff when I was young. Played FIFA or Madden until 4 or 5 in the morning. Yeah. Then turning right around and go to work at 9 or 10. Those are the days. You can do that when you're young. When you get older, you're in bed by 10. Let me just tell you.
Oh, I'm already feeling it, man. I'm not a spring chicken. Like, I'm 31. So, like, it's one of those things where I can still do it,
yeah,
but I'm gonna feel the repercussions later.
Yeah,
I'll tell you that much.
Shout out, I remember being 31. All right, anyway, let's move on. You know how Mailbag works, my friends who are watching here. We get your questions, and then I go through all of them, and I send them on to my guest. My guest picks a 5 out of like the 20 or 25 or so questions that I send him, and we talk about them on the show. I want to tell you, got a lot of great questions from you all. And if you want to participate in Mailbag, you can send your question in when we put the calls out on social media, on Twitter and on Instagram. Look for that call out and put the hashtag Collider Mailbag on your question. Makes it easier for me to find. And hey, if you hate social media or don't want to be on social media, you can email us at mailbag@collider.com. I pour through all those questions to find out some really great ones that we can answer for you. And I think we've picked 5 really good ones.
I think so too.
Yeah.
I like these questions.
Me
really
too.
Yeah.
All right, let's jump into it. Our first question is a Twitter question. It's from @MikeMixtape. He asks, "Hi everyone, my favorite type of sci-fi films involve time travel. Why do you think there's a lack of time travel films in recent years? There's the occasional time travel films like See You Yesterday and Avengers Endgame. Is time travel not marketable anymore?" Winston.
Is time travel not marketable anymore? No, I think time travel is super marketable. I think the issue is it's one of the most complex storylines you could possibly do.
Yes.
So that gets difficult. It's funny. Most black people know that there's kind of a running joke about how there's not really a great time for a black person to travel back in time. like if you think about it, like there's a couple things, like I want to go back to what? The day Obama got elected.
Like
that was great.
Okay. Okay. Ancient Egypt, Cleopatra.
The Million Man March. But like, that's about it. I'm not trying to go back to Jim Crow. I'm not trying to go back to slavery. I'm not trying to run away from lions in Africa. Like, there's not a lot of good times when black people go back in time, if I'll be real.
This is the greatest first question we've ever gotten.
Right? That's why as soon as I saw it, I was geeked. But mainly because you mentioned See You Yesterday.
Yeah.
I absolutely love that movie. For those that haven't seen it, like, I won't do any spoilers, but they do leave it open-ended as well, which... I just really love that you took an opportunity, that joke of there's not a good time to go back. That's like one of the rare times. The plot, for those that don't know, is two young black scientists in high school invent time travel. One of the kid's older brothers gets killed by a cop in like an unarmed, black youth getting killed scenario. So they keep traveling back in time to that day to try and stop the girl's brother from getting killed, which I think is an amazing plot point to use to put towards a modern like issue that we're seeing constantly right now. But of course, like that, why time travel is hard, you have to explain your time travel rules, which I love that Endgame made a joke about that.
Yeah, with Back
to Future versus whatever, you know what I'm saying? So you have to explain how it works. There is the advantage point of you can use a lot of the same footage you already shot because you're going back to the same thing, but then you have to make those little tweaks. Continuity becomes super hard because of that. That's one of the things you have to take into consideration. There's just a lot going on. So when it's done well, it's awesome. I love Hot Tub Time Machine, Days of Future Past.
Yeah.
Probably one of my favorites would be Looper.
Oh yeah,
Looper's great. Really good. But it's just hard. I think that's the big thing, is it's hard. And it's, you want to come up with something original. We've all seen the, oh, you made out with your mom before, or your sister, or whatever. Ooh, you know, like, we have to stop substance from happening and the butterfly effect happening one way or the other. Mm. So it's just difficult, I think.
I think that's a great point you bring up, though, with See You Yesterday. We've seen so many time travel films. So, Mike, a mixtape, I got to push back on you a little bit on this question. Let me run you through, since the year 2000, just some of the time travel movies. Doctor Strange, Looper, as Winston mentioned, Source Code, Days of Future Past, Interstellar, Edge of Tomorrow, Arrival, About Time, Hot Tub Time Machine, Primer, Time Traveler's Wife, and even the reboot of Star Trek had time travel involved in it. So there's been a lot of actually, since the year 2000. So in the last 18, 19 years, we've had actually a lot of time travel movies. Before there were a dearth of them in the 70s and 80s and 60s. So I would argue that there have been a lot actually. I think because we as a society are becoming more technologically proficient and aware and a little more intelligent about this idea of time travel and chaos theory and all this kind of stuff, that look, they made it a central part of Avengers Endgame, a 3-hour movie that is the 22nd MCU film. So they felt the public, they could handle taking the public through a time travel story because they've advanced enough to consume it. So I get your point, but I would say, Mike, maybe you're not seeing enough of them, of these all lists, and considering them time travel movies. Those are time travel movies. So, but Winston's initial comment is correct. It's a difficult thing to get across and a difficult thing to explain to your audience. And a new way in is always what sells a film better. Uniquely, if you're going to do a time travel thing, okay, what's going to separate this from the other time travel movies we've already seen? Source Code was a really inventive way to do it when you find out what the twist is at the end of that one. You mentioned See You Yesterday using a cop killing a young black man, a topical story as a flashpoint for the time machine. Hot Tub Time Machine is funny, going back in time to a high school and what goes on with that. Such a great film, which that sequel ruined, but the first film is fantastic. Oh, don't ever see it. Don't ever see that sequel. But even something like Star Trek uses time travel to convey something that happens and then readjusts the timeline for a new franchise, a new reboot of a franchise going forward. So time travel has been used a lot. We'll see if maybe, Mike, you haven't seen a lot of these. Maybe get out and see more of these and see for yourself. All right, what's our next question there?
Our next question, an email from Cedric Moore II. What's good, Ced? How you doing, Doug? It says, hey, all, hope you're well and enjoying your day. I recently read a Forbes article by Scott Mendelson, and he accused the MCU of almost solely sticking to the perspective of its heroes. My question is, do you think a smaller MCU film could work if it didn't focus on this perspective? Is the brand big enough to get people to see a film like this? An example I pick would be a dramatic film that focuses on the effects of the snap on society as a whole, to see how it affected the people, relationships, the government, religion, etc. Thanks, guys.
I think this is a great question. I don't think Scott was accusing Marvel. I think Scott was just pointing it out. Mm-hmm. And by the way, once again, I knew Scott before he became Scott and I worked together testing DVDs at a facility way back in the old days. And we would argue about film all the time.
Okay.
And so Scott now has become a well-known writer for Forbes and stuff. Right. But I remember when he was writing for the Toluca Times and not getting paid a dime. And he would always tell me, I would always say to him, why do you write for this? And he's like, because I'm building my resume to get to where I'm going. So shout out to Scott. I love reading his stuff. So this idea of the MCU focusing on a villain perspective or another perspective besides the heroes, I think it's dangerous for Marvel. It's difficult for them to do it. I think they could do it as like special features things or like a special like a short film they could add to a deep, like I think they did that with the first Avengers film with the waitress that Joss Whedon had cast, what her perspective was watching everything that happened from the in New York. But I think it would be difficult because Marvel's not built that way. I think DC is more built that way, where it focuses on its villains having as much personality as its heroes. When on the Marvel side, you get more of the gods, right? Galactus and Thanos and all that kind of jazz. Really, Magneto is the one that you would focus on if you were going to do something like that. And I wonder, now they're in the MCU, but I wonder if they would have the chance to do that, because we see the Joker coming out this year. That works because the Joker is by itself a standalone thing. I think Marvel's focus is always on trying to convert villains into heroes and explore the gray area of that, whereas DC is more about having its villains be the central part of certain things, and the fans love that because it's more human-based. Mm-hmm. What do you think?
I would actually counter that. I would say I think you could do it. I think as far as if you're going to do something like following around people in society with the snapping, I think that the fact that Disney is building Disney Plus, that's an easy avenue to do that as like as kind of a show. I know they sort of tried to do that, not with, it was with DC, not with Marvel. Mm. I think the show was called like Powerless or something.
Oh, yeah,
The cleanup crew, and it just didn't do well. But I think that put in the right hands, you know, Marvel TV has really proven that they can do so. So I think that that could be a great avenue. Mm. But I would counter and say that I do think that you could, because we've gotten such well-rounded villains in phase three. So you're talking Thanos, you're talking Killmonger. I don't think they flushed it out very well, but what's his name from Civil War?
Baron Zemo.
Thank you, Zemo. Yeah. If you flush it out correctly, you could do like a Masters of Evil film, or you could do a Doctor Doom film since Doom is coming, and he's such a well-versed character. You mentioned Magneto. Mm-hmm. I think you could do something along those lines, but I think it would have to set up kind of like what you said. You're dealing with another galactic threat.
Yeah.
So that they're going to have to put their differences aside. Because I do think it'd be interesting, because it happens in comics all the time, mm-hmm. and you've seen it in Avengers TV shows, in Justice League TV shows, like when they did the Task Force X episode, Suicide Squad episode of Justice League. There's sometimes where the bad guys, to get that other side of it, you are getting a chance to not only see where they're coming from, but you're kind of setting up a bigger plot point later. So I wouldn't necessarily have a problem with like a movie or two of that happening.
Yeah.
You would just have to do it properly. And I think that's where you look at, if James Gunn, I know this is, we're jumping franchises here, but if James Gunn does well with the Suicide Squad, because it obviously was not done well the first time, you could potentially see something like that happening in the future. It just depends if Marvel is brave enough to do it.
Yeah.
I think that that would be, you know, that would be a cool experiment. I would love to see how that goes.
Yeah, especially, I wonder under the Disney banner if they would allow that to happen, whereas WB is more of a free-flowing thing,
sure.
right? Which is why you have the Joker and rumors of Black Adam having his own movie.
Right.
And you mentioned Suicide Squad. That was already, in essence, kind of, because Guardians of the Galaxy were good people,
right.
heroes in their own ways. Suicide Squad, these were villains. So, right. like, that is, I think DC explores that more, but certainly getting something from the Marvel side that's villain-centric would be fun for us who are massive fans of the source material to see. Well, I just wonder if Disney would allow that to happen.
No, I hear you. I guess it's just from the standpoint that, again, like, I look at Killmonger and Thanos, and I look at how I spent so much time genuinely invested and even at some points rooting for them, just because I understand where they're coming from. Like, I understand that for Killmonger, it's like, this is what it was like for African Americans, and y'all didn't do nothing to help us.
Right.
So not only am I going to come blast y'all for doing that, but then I'm going to go take over the world. Like, I don't want him to take over the world, and I do like the Wakandans, but, like, I understood where he was coming from, so there were moments where I was like, no, I feel you.
Yeah.
And, like, I appreciate the MCU not going the standard Thanos loves death and letting that be what's his driving force, to actually be like, I'm genuinely concerned about the population of the universe and how we're going to self-implode. That made him an interesting character.
Agreed. So. Overpopulation. Interesting stuff. All right, let's move on to our next question. It's a Twitter question from @IamFresh_23, if he says so himself. With rumors, with rumors of Fantastic Four coming to the MCU in Phase 4, what are your guys' picks for director, which Peyton Reed is rumored for, and cast? All right.
That's a great question. I like Peyton Reed. I think that would be a great choice.
Yeah.
This is a stretch, and I don't think he would ever do it.
No pun intended, a stretch, yes.
I didn't, oh, God. Oh, I hate myself right now.
That's Oreos talking, son.
Yeah, it really is. It's a sugar crash. I would love if Christopher Nolan would do it, but he's his his own brand.
Yeah.
So I don't think he would ever do that. If Patty Jenkins ever decided to jump, I think that she's proven that she can take on a major action blockbuster. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I would love to see, she's very good at taking a female superhero and pushing. I would love to see Sue getting like a lot of center stage kind of there. Mm-hmm. Trying to think, there was one other director off the top of my brain. Oh, this is also going to be a stretch because she's only had one film and it's successful, but it wasn't a box office smash because it was small. I would love to see Olivia Wilde take the reins of that.
I feel like the
teamwork that she did with her cinematographers, some beautiful shots would be absolutely cool. She's clearly got like a bantery wit going on, like as you saw in Booksmart, that she's able to direct. So I would love to, obviously Johnny and Ben have a lot of that going back and forth. So I would love to see that too.
Mm-hmm.
As far as casting goes, some of the people that were just floating around in my head, I think Nicholas Holt has proven that he can play, He's good at playing kind of the nerd, so I think he'd be a great Reed. But I also think he'd be a great Doom.
Yeah.
If they go with Doom again as a villain, I think he would be an awesome Doom. He showed, like, I didn't like Dark Phoenix, but he showed us a lot of those flashes of anger in Dark Phoenix. So he could show that dark side of Doom that's there, you know? I think that would be really cool.
Yeah. Certainly in The Favorite, he was kind of a jerk, so it would be, it would work completely.
He was great in The Favorite. I completely forgot about that because I didn't like that movie, but I loved I loved individual performances.
Right.
Just trying to think who else. I mean, he's already, you know, the Drax, but Batista would be great as the Thing.
Yeah.
Maybe if John Cena wants to play a superhero, I think he could be a great Thing. He has great comedic timing, obviously the right physique for it.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I was throwing around, she'd be a little young right now, but it depends on when they start filming. I think Chloe Getz, I'd never pronounced
it. Oh, Chloe Grace Moretz.
Yes. I think she would be a great Sue. I think that, like, you know, she's maturing, so she's starting to look a little bit older and whatnot, which is good. I think she's shown that she can do a superhero movie with the Kick-Ass series.
Yeah.
So I just think that would be a lot of fun. I haven't really thought about Johnny. A lot of people could play Johnny. I just haven't thought that far ahead. What about you?
Yeah, for me, if we're looking at directors besides Peyton Reed, Peyton Reed's a great choice. Obviously, I've been a fan of his for quite some time. I think John Krasinski would be interesting, having done A Quiet Place, where he did direct himself and his wife. Couldn't he step into the role here and direct Fantastic Four, casting himself as Reed Richards and his wife as Sue, which a lot of people have been fantasy casting already.
That's great.
Yeah, I think Brad Bird would be interesting, considering he already had a dry run on The Incredibles as the director of the animated version of the Fantastic Four. Wouldn't that be interesting to see him come back to a live-action version? Mm-hmm. Christopher McQuarrie, I think, would be nice from the Mission Impossible series. He'd be great to jump into this. And Edgar Wright. Maybe welcome him back after the Ant-Man debacle. Bring Edgar Wright back into the fold and have him direct Fantastic Four. I think that would be a fun situation overall.
You did better than me on this question, sir.
I will handle the directing side. The casting stuff, I think you did a nice job with that. My mind can't go past Reed. I can't go past Krasinski and Emily Blunt. I think it's just perfect casting. Those two, right? And so I would hesitate to cast anyone else in those roles because I think they're perfect. And I want an older, mature Fantastic Four. I don't want Fantastic Four in their 20s. I want mature that approach to it. So it'd be fun to see them be like the statesmen. If we're going to go with a young Avengers route, you need to have a group that's a little bit older that can kind of be the guide or the counselor for the younger
kind of
team.
Balance them out. Yeah. That's a great idea.
Let's move on to our fourth question.
Yeah. Got this one. Yeah. So Twitter question from at CW Bardshire. Whatever that means. Hey, Roka and company, just wondering about your thoughts on Swamp Thing being canceled after airing only one episode. Do you think this is indicative of ratings, quality of show, or chink in the armor of Warner Streaming, or some kind of mixture of the three? Hashtag Collider Mailbag.
It's a good question. There's a lot of stuff going on, a lot of different articles being written about what happened, a lot of Twitter threads from people who are verified, so that you would think they have the information correct. It's about the $40 million tax credit. It's about some kind of paperwork error that was made. But also behind the scenes, there was a lot of egos clashing here about the direction of the show, creative differences. Now, all that being said, they still dropped a pretty awesome first episode that a lot of people loved. And I think they should have let this thing breathe for a little while, then come to the end of it, and then cancel it like Netflix did with their Marvel shows. They let all of them come out, and then they canceled them because they knew they were moving on to another series, or they're just going to stop and start all over again. Either way, it's the rumors going around is that DC is going to be folded into the WB streaming app, which I think is right now $16.99 is the rumored price for it, which is a lot for a streaming service like Warner Brothers, and that's great to fold it in. But I just think the look of this is terrible, because why even drop the first episode and then cancel right afterwards? Because then people don't have a desire to see the rest of the season, because they don't. There's no point in investing in something that you know is not going to keep going.
Right.
And that was a massive mistake. So I think all of that came together. It was a bad, bad combination of X factors all around that caused this thing to be canceled, unfortunately. And it's bad optics for Warner Brothers and DC.
I'm curious, just in the standpoint of what technically is a worse move, to let the season play out and then to cancel it if people love it.
Yeah.
or if you nip it in the bud early, no pun intended, you know, since we're talking the swamp and everything.
You're full of them today.
I just, bro, like the more delirious I get, I'm just like,
Great. Sports time is going to be fun.
Oh, right? It's going to be a bit. Don't worry, I'll grab a 5 hour before that. So I've been doing reviews of the DC Universe shows with Jay Washington. That's right. For those that don't know, so we did all of Doom Patrol, and we just started on Swamp Thing. And you know, I agree. Like I've to that point, I've seen 2 episodes already, and I personally, Jay loves them both. Mm-hmm. I personally love the pilot. I wasn't as big a fan of the second episode, mm-hmm. So I can see where there might be a little bit of a debate about the creative side of things, about what direction they're going. So I can see that. But I think people are really underestimating how much this tax credit is a big deal. Like, literally think of it this way. For anybody that's ever done a budget at all before, let's say you're buying a house. Forget that. Let's say you're planning a party. You're planning your birthday party, right?
Let's keep it simple.
I'll just keep it real simple. And someone tells you, like, yo, I got $40 to go and get, like, snacks. Or no. You have $100. And someone tells you, I'll give you $40 for your party to plan stuff. And then when they show up, they're like, here you go. Here's $14. No. I bought like an extra handle. I went and got the extra size, like Doritos bag, the extra large size. Like, I need you to give me the $40 you promised, man. It's like, oh, I'm sorry, we messed up. You thought I said 40, I meant 14. You know, in that text message, that was a typo. That's a big deal, like for a small time budget. So 40 million, when you're dealing with a scale that big, you had to pay actors, you had to pay your director, you had to pay location scouts, all that stuff. That's a pretty massive hit. And think about how many movies have had like a $100 million budget and don't even make that back, that never get sequels. Mm. Even if they were good, if they don't make it back, this is a business at the end of the day. And that's really what it is that money thing's a big deal. So I think that's really at the core of what's going on here. Yeah. I would hope. And, you know, it's interesting. People are saying, well, why not just take the show and have a smaller season next season?
Yeah.
Like keep the same quality, but then instead of, you know, 10 episodes, go it down to 5. I think the issue with that is a lot of that too also sometimes becomes a kiss of death. The less episodes you take away, like they started with 13.
Yeah.
And they dropped to 10.
Yeah.
So then you're going to drop it to 5. Like that doesn't bode well. So. Mm. I hope we see some sort of revival. People are trying and pushing for it, but I don't see it in the cards, unfortunately.
I think so too. I think it's just going to be all folded into Warner's, and then they're going to start whole new shows and start all over again. So we'll see. All right, our last question is an Instagram question from Dizzy P3. He asks, with easy accessibility to trailers thanks to the internet, why do you think certain theaters still show 20 minutes of trailers before a film? Gone are the days where the movie theaters were the only place to see a full trailer. Winston.
I have 2 answers for this.
Okay, yeah, let's go.
The first answer is for all of our parents that, like, they don't surf the internet like that. They barely know how to use Facebook.
Fair.
So that's how they know what movies are coming. Mm-hmm. That's how that goes. And I also throw into that, even though kids are very adept, like, my nephew learned how to use an iPad at, like, 1.
It's mind-blowing.
So, like, it's very crazy how they can do that. But the flip side of that, too, is that when you're going to see Secret Life of Pets 2, when all of a sudden the Lion King thing comes up, that my nephew can geek out because he's probably not watching trailers the same way anybody from the ages of 15 to say 45 are doing on the internet. So that's the first reason. The second and more important reason is because I think they're very aware, as populated as things are and as late as I am to everything, that that's really a buffer time for people to get settled. That's really all that is at that point. If you just started movies right away like that, you're going to see a lot of issues, because you could have anything from, I was waiting in a long line from concession stand, I couldn't find parking, like whatever infinite number of things that would cause someone to be late for a movie. Yeah. The trailers at this point, I honestly believe, have become a buffer period to allow people to get settled and sit down and not be talking and all that kind of stuff. So my girlfriend freaks out every time we go to the movies, because I'm like the movie's at what, 3, and like we're leaving the house at 3 because we live like a good 10 minutes from the theater. She's like, are you kidding me? Like all of the millions of things go wrong. I'm like, baby, it will be fine. So the last time we went, I dropped her off at the front door because she was panicked.
Yeah.
And I literally sat down as the AMC was like, thank you for joining us for AMC. She's like, fine, you were right. So I would feel that's the thing. And the last thing is, big blockbusters, it's great to see those trailers on a big screen, mm-hmm. instead of just on your little phone.
Agreed.
Things like that.
I think that's a part of it as well. And also, when you're dealing with 20 minutes of trailers, you're usually looking at a multiplex that does that. And it's because they have 15 theaters to fill movies with, and they want to know that you, mom and pop who can't get access to it, or you who maybe don't know that these other films coming out that they're going to put up there, you go and see them. Because most people are just kind of tend to go towards the superhero blockbuster stuff. Nowadays, they don't really look for the adult, more mature fare, or the more the independent films that sometimes will screen at AMCs or the multiplexes. So they go there. But you go to the smaller theater chains, they usually do two or three. Something like Arclight here in LA is a rarity, where it's a big multiplex, but it's a, it respects film and the medium of film so much. They only put two or three trailers ahead of a trailer, ahead of a movie rather. And the smaller independent theaters only do two or three or four at most, but it's usually to put you in the vibe of the movie you're about to see.
Right.
So that kind of stuff is always a part of it. And to be honest with you, we should actually be grateful, because I was reading this article in The Atlantic, and it talked about how trailers in the 60s and the 70s were 3 to 4 minutes long, 5 to 6 minutes long sometimes to promote a film. So we're only getting 2 minute trailers in the theaters. That was passed down over the last few years from some of the theater owners. They said they want only 2 minute trailers so that they can stack them back to back to back quickly while people are getting concessions or parking or coming late to the movie and what have you. So it works out that way. So I think that's what it is. It's the matter of they want to promote their films, but also they want to allow people to come a little bit late if they need to, because people are busy working multiple jobs, kids, what have you. They are sometimes late and don't want to miss the movie.
See, that's a good one. I didn't even think about that. That's the last late excuse, wrangling kids, bro.
Oh, yeah.
Especially if you're the parent that, like, you know, you brought your kids, but then, like, you brought their friends.
Yeah.
So you're rolling with, like, 4-5 deep. Like, oh, God. I would like to formally apologize to my mother and the mothers of my friends, because I didn't, we weren't bad, but I'm, like, thinking about us during Star Wars, walking around with lightsabers, like, just like, woo, woo, like, I need Sour Patch Kids, like, that, I salute y'all. Happy post Mother's Day. Happy future Father's Day. I just, oh, Lord
there
Jesus.
Go. There you go. All right. Well, that's a great way to end this episode of Collider Mailbag. I want to thank Winston A. Marshall for stopping by.
Thanks for
having
me.
Always good to see you, brother, man. Hey, where can they find you and the stuff you do, brother?
Yeah. You can find me on social media at the Swaggy Blurred, TheSwaggyBlerd. That's Twitter, Instagram, all that good stuff. And I actually have a, follow me on social media, because I have a big TV appearance coming up in like a week or two. I can't say anything quite yet, but as soon as I can, I'll put it on there. So, yeah.
And if you want to see, what's the commercial you just did? Was that?
Oh, two of my three, and one is just running anyway, just got renewed. So there's a Johnsonville sausage commercial that just got reviewed, a Krylon spray paint commercial that just got renewed, and I've been the face of celiac disease for 23andMe. For almost a full year now.
There you go.
There you go.
It's good money. It's good stuff, that commercial stuff.
Right.
It's good money. All right. You can follow me at The Roca Says on Twitter and on Instagram. I want to thank you all for watching. And remember, as I said at the beginning, if you want to send in your questions and get picked, do so. We put the call out on social media, on Twitter and on Instagram. See that post there with the graphic Collider Mailbag. Send in your question. Put that hashtag Collider Mailbag on it so I can find it easier. And also, if you don't want to do social media, you can email us at mailbag@collider.com. Send it in. Pour through those questions. Pick out the best ones. All right. Thanks, everybody, for watching. And we will see you next week for two more episodes of Collider Mailbag.